Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day that you have given to us, that we could come to your house, that we could worship you, that we could study your word, Lord. I just thank you for all the blessings that you give to each and every one of us, Lord. Just pray that you would be with the offering as we take it up this morning, that it would meet the needs of the church, and that we would be wise in doing with those monies as you would see fit, Lord. Just pray that you'd be with all the prayer requests that we have, many sick and ill, Lord. Just pray that your hand would be upon each and every one of them. Just pray that you'd be with us as we prepare for the message that you have given to the pastor to bring to us today, that we would be open to your leading, to your guiding, that we would respond to your word, and that we would do what you would have for us to do. Thank you for all you've given us, and ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Great old song, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim. See, we have a problem. I have no words. What is that?
Redeemed and so happy in Jesus.
What number are we? 557. See, fortunately, we have a backup. 557 in your hymn book. Thank you, sir. All right. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, right? So when we say happy, what are we going to do?
Smile.
Please do.
Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. I know that the light of his presence with me doth continually dwell. I know I shall see in his beauty the King whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed.
One another this morning. Good singing and for being able to use the hymn book and being able to read. Technology's wonderful when it works, isn't it? Amen. All right, you may be seated. The ensemble and the choir is going to sing My Story. As we sing, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, as the children go on to Children's Church. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in
Though the darkness find thee, though the eye of sin.
Be seated. Jamie's going to come at your special.
Some people try to listen to the bottom of a bottle. Some people try to listen to a needle in their arm. Some people try to listen to the money in their pocket. Some people try to listen to another's arms. But you and I are not that different. We got a void that we're just trying to fill up. Something that'll give just a little peace. All we want is a hand to reach to. Open up. Say I love you. We'd give anything to hear the voice of the
Savior.
Some people try to find it with blind ambition. Some people try to find it where no one else has gone. Some people try to find it in the crowns of victory. Some people get defeated and lose the strength to carry on. Cause you and I are not that different. We got a void that we're just trying to fill up. Something that'll give just a little. All we want is a hand to reach to, open arms and say I love you. We'd give anything to hear the voice of the Savior. And some people try to find it in the shadow of a steeple. Some people try to find it in the back row pew. And some people try to find it in the arms of Jesus. That's where I found it. How about you? 'Cause you and I are not that different. We got a void that we're just trying.
awesome, awesome song. What a thought. What a truth. I mean, we're all looking for something, aren't we? Let's just face it. That's what is going on today with you and me and everybody else in this world. And all of our ambitions, all of the things that we are drawn to is because we're looking for something or someone to fill a void in our life. And that void can only be filled by God Himself. And He is there, as the song said, with open arms. And He will accept anyone who comes to Him. And I hope this morning, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, that before you leave today, that you'll go to His open arms and ask Him to save your soul. Become God's child and have that void inside your heart filled once and for all. What a blessing it is to know that we can have a relationship with God through Jesus. Well, thank you again for the song. Go ahead and open your Bibles, if you would, to Acts chapter 24. Acts chapter 24. If you don't have a Bible with you, we encourage you to use one there in the pew just so you can see right along with us what the Bible says. Acts 24 can be found on page 963 in the Pew Bible. Page 963 in the Pew Bible. I'm excited about the Thanksgiving offering this year. Our children and teens areas have needed some renovations, and you know, we really felt led this year that this would be the area that we would use the Thanksgiving offering for, to renovate it. And we're going to, in a couple of, maybe even next week, but in a couple of weeks, we're going to have a little slideshow to show kind of the before pictures and what we could do in those spaces to make them really nice and first class for our young people and for our teenagers and our children. Here's my hope. My hope and my goal for that, for the Thanksgiving offering, is that we, the Lord blesses so much that we're not only able to renovate the teen and the children's space to make a whole children's suite up in this section of the second floor, first class place for the kids to come. Think about it, you know, a check-in area and a nice area for the kids to learn about the Word of God, something that'll be fun for them, they'll look forward to going to. And my hope is that we will also be able to put carpet in and paint and really spruce up our front runner's room as well. And what a blessing that would be just to renovate every space we have, you know. And so I'm praying and I'm hoping and hopefully you'll consider giving out of a heart of gratitude to Jesus that we could really just spruce the whole place up and make it look super sharp for the glory of God, you know, for the glory of God. Make it a place that will be welcoming and warm and inviting. And we know we have the people here who are welcoming and warm and inviting, and we thank the Lord for that, and we just want to spruce it up a little bit for the glory of God. So think about how you may give, pray about how you may give, and as the Lord leads you, do that, and looking forward for a great, great way to honor God and show Him our gratitude from our hearts. So I hope you're excited about that. Begin praying about it. This morning, we're going to start a 4-Sunday morning series called Almost and Close. And you see how I kind of smashed the letters there together to close? Okay, that was my bad attempt to make it look cool. You probably are like, what does that say? Yeah, it's supposed to say close, all right? Almost and close. And the idea is we're going to look at instances in the Bible where people were close to making a decision, close to Jesus, almost there, and for whatever reason, stopped short of letting God work in their heart and life. And so the next 4 Sunday mornings, we're going to look at a topic called Almost and Close. And this morning, we're going to look at a fella. He is he's the procurator of a place called Galilee, Israel. And he was there on behalf of Rome. And we're going to look at his instance where he was close. But here, I want you to consider a few things this morning. Consider these phrases. I'll do it later. Maybe some other time. I can't right now. Probably all of us have said that one time or another, usually to people who are calling us and asking if we want our dream vacation, right? I can't right now. Maybe some other time. I'll do it later. Each of those phrases contains 4 words that could be innocent enough, but 4 words that speculate that we'll have another opportunity some other time. And you and I both know that we're not promised another day. We're not promised another minute. It's just the facts of life. We all know we have a time, right? We all have a birthday that we celebrate. And we all have that dash in between our birth date and our death date. And that dash is what we do with our life. And then that death date, we don't know what it is. But there is one. So we're not promised another day. And so I'll do it later, maybe some other time, or I can't right now, could also be devastating. Today we're going to begin this series called Almost and Close. And it's based on the idea that we make many plans, don't we? We make so many plans. I mean, just this morning we had the fellow from the funeral home come and give calendars. How ironic is that, right? The funeral home gives us a calendar, all right? But they put the calendars out there. They do that every year as just a gift for us to say, here's a calendar for you to take home or whatever, has their advertisement on it. In case you ever need their services, you can call them after the fact. But we make plans. Grace, our daughter, she's been planning a Disney trip for her senior year for graduation. She's been planning this trip for 4 years, all right? And we have heard for 4 years all that she wants to do in Disney World. And I can tell you almost everything that she wants to do. She's been planning, and Lord willing, we'll get to do that. I'm planning on, if the Lord allows, winning the fishing contest again next year at the men's retreat, all right? So that's my plan, all right? I'm doing pretty well in the past, so that's my plan. And a lot of folks here today, you have plans of where you're going to have lunch today. And if you haven't, stop now, okay? You'll figure that out after the message. We don't need to plan that right now. But we make plans, don't we? That's really what we do nowadays. We have calendars everywhere on our phones and in our cars and in our desk and on our refrigerator. We make plans. We're banking on the idea that things are going to happen down the road. And we think maybe we'll wait for that circumstance to be better or different before we make a decision. You know, the best time to respond to God's prompting is the very moment He speaks. As soon as we realize that God is speaking to our heart, that's the best time to respond and obey. The question is, are you willing to obey the Lord this morning as He directs your heart and mind? Today we're going to see the account of a very important man in Roman government in the first century. He was given an opportunity by God to make a decision that would affect his eternity. What did he do? We'll find out. Consequently, we'll answer the question, what will we do when we're confronted with opportunities from God? What we're going to do this morning is we're going to begin in verse 24. So we're in chapter 24. We're going to go to the very end of the chapter, and we're going to read the very end of this account. And then we're going to start from the beginning, and we're going to tell the story of what happened to lead up to what we're about to read. So this is the very end of what happens, okay? So Acts chapter 24, verse 24. It says, and after certain days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewess, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee. He hoped also that money should have been given him of Paul, that he might loose him. Wherefore he sent for him the oftener and communed with him. But after 2 years, Porcius Festus came into Felix's room. And Felix, willing to show the Jews a pleasure, left Paul bound. All right, let's pray this morning. Our Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come to church today to be with our friends and loved ones, brothers and sisters in Christ, to be around people, Lord, who love you. And Lord, we thank you for the music that we've sung and heard and how it has lifted our hearts and brought these great truths to our minds. And Lord, the praise that was lifted to you through song, we ask this morning that it would be a blessing to you. And Lord, now as we come to the time of your word, I ask that you would open our hearts and minds, that the Holy Spirit would have freedom and liberty to do whatever he wants here today, that He can touch every single heart, Lord, that we'll have open hearts and minds, and we'll obey as He speaks. Would You please do a miracle in our presence this morning? Maybe, Lord, today there's someone here who doesn't know Jesus as their Savior. And maybe today, Lord, Your Holy Spirit would convict them not to wait any longer, not to put it off, but to take care of that today. And Lord, for those of us who know Christ, that if there's someone we need to talk to, that we wouldn't assume that we've got bunches of time to share the gospel, but Lord, that we would get right on it and share the gospel as soon as the opportunity is there. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And so this morning, we're going to look at what we're calling Felix's dangerous decision. Felix's dangerous decision. So we saw how it ended, all right? Felix was there. He heard Paul. Paul preached to him. And Felix said, you know what? When I get a better time, maybe a little bit later, we'll talk again, and then I'll make this decision. And he sent Paul away. It tells us that he communed with him more often. He'd bring him in and talk to Paul a little bit more. But what was his motive? We saw it, didn't we? His motive was that Paul would pay him off and that he'd let him go for a bribe. But that never happened. So Felix left Paul in prison for 2 more years. And then a new guy came on, a guy by the name of Porcius Festus. He took over Felix's job there. And as far as we know, Felix never again had an encounter with Paul or never again heard the gospel. So what led to that? What led to that encounter with Paul? And I wonder, as we read, or as you can follow through, what I'm going to be kind of paraphrasing or summing up for you starts in verse 1 of chapter 24. You can kind of follow along if you'd like and just see what happened here with Paul. What led to this encounter? Well, Paul was a former Jewish persecutor of Christians, who is now a Christian himself. In fact, he was the most outspoken and proven missionary in the first century. He has been imprisoned for converting Jews and many Gentiles to Christianity. And now, Paul is brought before Felix, the procurator of Judea, governor, if you will. Felix is an extension of the emperor of Rome. So he is a very important role, and he answers directly to the emperor of Rome. He was a man with great power in Judea. Felix was a well-established man in his position. He had held that position for about 9 years or so, and he knew and governed the region very well. Paul had an accuser, a guy by the name of Tertullus. He was an orator, a silver-tongued lawyer. Okay, and he stood before Felix trying to sling all kind of mud at Paul. He spread great lies about Paul to Felix and what his business was in Jerusalem. He called Paul a pestilent fellow and a mover of sedition. That's a real nice way of being a jerk, okay? He said Paul's a troublemaker and causes violent riots among the Jews and Gentiles. He called Paul the ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. Nazarenes because Jesus was from a town called Nazareth. This implies that Paul is a lawbreaker and a heretic. In other words, Paul has neither regard for Holy Scripture nor for man's laws. And if you're a governor and you've got a loose cannon like that, you're going to want to take care of him, keep him locked up, or get rid of him. And this is the case that Tertullus is making against Paul. So Tertullus finishes, and Felix gives Paul an opportunity to speak for himself. So Paul acknowledges Felix's tenure as governor and does so respectfully and tastefully. And he also brings to the court's attention the fact that since Felix, this isn't his first rodeo, that he's going to be fair in this judgment. Paul defends himself by stating that he indeed came to Jerusalem to celebrate Pentecost, and bring relief to the church, give some offerings to the churches there in Jerusalem. He reminds the court of this, that no man can back up the claims made by Tertullus. Nobody can give evidence of what Tertullus is saying about him. No one will fault Paul for for living the way that he lives. He said, in fact, that all things are written in the law and the prophets. He believes. He said that before the court. And after all, it's the letter of the law Pharisees who were against Paul as well. And they had to respect the fact that Paul lived by the letter of the law. In verse 15, Paul speaks of the resurrection of the just and unjust. But it's not the end. Although judgment may be made here on earth, everyone will answer to Christ someday. And then Paul goes after directly the lies of Tertullus, that he's a troublemaker. And he says that in verse 16, that he has a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. In other words, he says, I'm not looking to cause any trouble with anybody, and I try to follow the law of God as closely as I can. After hearing Paul's defense, Felix realizes that Tertullus was up to no good. And Felix refuses to see Paul as guilty for the charges brought before him. But he also doesn't let Paul go free. He orders Paul to be kept imprisoned. Then after certain days, the Bible says, Felix says, you know what, I'd like to hear this Paul fella again, but this time I want to hear him speak of this Christ that he follows. And so, as we see in verse 24, that after certain days, Felix comes with his wife Drusilla, and he sent for Paul to hear him concerning the faith in Christ. What a move by Felix. He was a good judge in that he heard all of the evidence brought for and against Paul, and he realized that there was no evidence against Paul. And so he said, you know what, I'm not going to call this guy guilty, but I'm also not going to let him go. I think there's two reasons for that. One, as we know, Felix wanted a bribe. He wanted some money in his pocket. He wasn't going to just let a guy like Paul go without getting some benefit personally from that decision. But I also see in this that Felix was a curious man, and he was curious about what Paul was preaching. What is he saying, and why is he saying it? Why has this man given his whole life to go through all of Asia Minor and preach about this Jesus guy? What is so important to Paul about this? So he calls him in to hear what Paul would say about Jesus. And so he wants to hear concerning the faith in Christ. Verse 25, what does Paul do? He reasons with him of three things. Did you see that? Righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come. Righteousness, speaking of the righteousness and holiness of God. Paul preached about how God was holy. Paul may have gone back to Leviticus and said, "Be ye holy, for I am holy, saith the Lord." He preached, though, that God is righteous alone, that God is the only one that is sinless, and his Son, Jesus Christ, is the only man to ever live on this earth and never one time sin. This must have been something to Felix, because Felix was the kind of guy who had a sordid background. He was a Roman. He was a Roman governor. He had a lot of power, and he could do pretty much anything he wanted to. Felix, in fact, married Drusilla. She was actually a Jewish woman who was betrothed to a person in Asia. She broke off that betrothal because that man refused to become a full-fledged Jew. And then she was going to be with one of the princes of Syria, and that didn't work out. So she wound up with Felix, and this was his third wife. So Felix and Drusilla had been around the block, and they knew, as Paul preached of a righteous God, that they stood before this God as sinners. It wasn't hard for Felix and Drusilla to see that they indeed were sinners before a holy God. But you know what Satan does to you and me? He blinds us. He makes you and I think that we're pretty good, and that we kind of deserve God's favor. And that, you know, because we don't really do anything too bad, God is going to just someday, based on our pretty goodness, allow us to come into heaven and spend eternity with him. And the fact of the matter is, friends, that we're all sinners. Every one of us has broken God's rules. Every one of us has gone our own way. God has given us His standard, and unfortunately for you and me, His standard is perfection. Righteousness, what Paul is preaching about. And when you and I hear of righteousness, we only have one thing to say to ourselves if we're honest with ourselves, and that's we fall short. Have you recognized that in your life today? Do you realize that you've fallen short of God's perfect standard? See, this is what Paul is preaching to these people of power. And this is the exact truth that we need on November the 3rd of 2019 as well. So what else did he preach about? What else did Paul say? Well, he talked about righteousness, and then it talked about temperance. Temperance is just another word for self-control, being able to control oneself. Well, you can imagine being a governor of Rome. You could probably have anything you wanted at any time, right? You snap your fingers, your servants bring it to you. Self-control was not something that a leader in Felix's position would have to concern himself with too much. He pretty much called his own shots. Very self-centered, I'm sure. But look, you and I can look at someone like that and say, they get away with everything. But aren't we very self-centered too? Self-control is one of those things that is very scarce these days. Why? Because we're self-centered. And as long as I get what I want, I'm happy. Even if it's at the expense of other people's loss. Is that not true? I mean, how many times are we willing to let someone else have loss as long as we get what we want and think we deserve? This is our culture. This is our world. This is kind of our attitude nowadays. Self-centeredness. And we can control it as long as it's for us. But as long as something goes against us, we might lose our control. And what a message for 2019. Righteousness and temperance. What else did Paul say to him? We talked about judgment to come, which is something that, quite honestly, we don't talk about much anymore in church. I don't know if we've gotten afraid that we may scare people off, or if we've thought that, you know, judgment is a thing that is a bad thing. But I mean, as I read the Bible, it's a lot about judgment. There's a lot about God's wrath, and one of the most loving things that God does is talk about His wrath. Think about that for a second. If I didn't know that there was any problem with the way I am, then I don't need a Savior. But when I am made aware that there is a judgment to come for people just like me, who are not righteous like God, who are only concerned about myself, when I'm made aware that there is a judgment coming that God has reserved for those who reject Him and His way of salvation, it brings conviction into my heart. And we really need to be truthful with people who don't know Christ and tell them, yes, Jesus loves you, and yes, He died for you, but the reason He died for you is because you're a sinner before a holy God. And this holy God has prepared a place called hell for the devil and his angels. But guess what? Anybody who rejects God's only begotten Son will also spend eternity there. Listen, we need to know the whole truth. And the whole truth is that there is judgment to come. There's judgment to come for anybody who rejects Jesus. You will stand before God one day, and your name will not be found written in what is called the Lamb's Book of Life. And when He looks there, and your name is not written there, according to the Word of God, you will be cast into the lake of fire forever and ever. That is the true judgment that's coming for anyone who is without Christ. You say, why would you say that? Because we have to know the truth about ourselves. And we have to understand that there is a judgment in order to understand the grace of God through Jesus. Because while there is a judgment to come, there's also a grace to receive right now. And the grace of God is Jesus Christ, who died for your sins. Jesus took that penalty for you. He, as in a way, He stepped in between you and God and said, no, I'll take it. You pour it out on me. You give me the punishment of hell, and you turn your wrath and your anger and your hatred and sin, put it on me and give it to me. And then anybody who says, Lord Jesus, I believe, they can have my perfect record. Now that is the good side. That is the good news. Yes, there's a judgment to come, but there's a grace to be received. And I wonder this morning, friend, have you received the grace of God through Jesus Christ, the gift that is his death, burial, and resurrection? Have you received Jesus? Because that's what God's going to look for on that day of judgment. He's going to look for, have you received Christ? Nothing else. He's not going to look and say, well, you were a pretty good person, you paid your taxes, you took care of people, you helped the people around you, your neighbors, you took care of them, you're good and you're bad. If we put it on a balance, it's your good's better. That's not at all how that works. There's one way, and Jesus is that way. And we can plead and we can beg, and it's foolish and futile to do so, because God said there is none other name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. And that name is Jesus. So Paul stands before Felix. Can you imagine standing before a governor of Rome and preaching this truth, knowing that maybe Felix would get just so mad at Paul for telling him the truth that he would cast him into prison or even maybe have him beheaded on the spot? But Paul took the opportunity, and it convicts me, because I see here a compassionate Christian who didn't think of himself but thought of the souls of the people in front of him. And it convicts me, and it inspires me, and it challenges me not to be concerned about myself, to be concerned with those around me. Now, he preached that message, righteousness, temperance, judgment to come. What happened? How did Felix respond to that? Look at verse 25. Two words. Felix trembled. When was the last time you trembled out of fear? I mean, shook because you were afraid of something, or you were nervous about an encounter. Or maybe there was some truth given to you about yourself that made you go, oh no, I've been found out. And you literally shook. You know, that's a horrible feeling. That is one of the worst things in the world, when you're confronted with the truth that you have messed up royally and that you have messed up in a way that there's only one solution, and that is to what? Humble yourself and say, yeah, I did do it. And I'm sorry. That's tough. And especially for a governor of Rome, who nobody tells what to do, except for Caesar himself. He hears this message and he's trembling, not because of Paul, but because the Holy Spirit of God is digging in. And the Holy Spirit of God is saying to Felix, this is you, man. You have fallen short. Would you reach out to Jesus? And Felix trembled. I wonder if you're here this morning and you realize that you have fallen short before God and you need to reach out to Jesus. And maybe you're sitting there in your pew and people can't tell, but on the inside you're trembling because you know you need to call out to Jesus. Listen, call out to him. Humble yourself. It's worth it. It's worth humbling yourself. Felix trembled, verse 25, and he answered. What would he say? You know, we would hope that Felix would say, Paul, you're right. I can sense that God's telling me I'm a sinner. I need to trust Jesus. But that's not what he says. He says, go thy way for this time. We would say it like this. Go away for now. Go on. Just leave the room for a minute. And then look at this phrase. Underline this in your Bible. When I have a convenient season, I will. When I have a better time, when I have more time, or when I'm not doing something else, when I'm not already busy, when I'm not already looking to do something, then I will. All these words recorded forever are very condemning words for Felix. Because he said, when I have a convenient season, I will. I wonder if you're doing that this morning, friend. Maybe God's speaking to your heart about being saved, and you're saying, well, maybe next time. Maybe when there's a, maybe it's a big Sunday, and, you know, I'll do it on that day. Or maybe I'll do it when there's not as many people around, and it won't be as embarrassing. Hey, friend, we're not promised next time. This was a dangerous decision that Felix made. He said, when it's more convenient, I will. and I'll call for you. I'll do it then, Paul. Verse 26, we see his motives here too. He hoped also that money should have been given to him of Paul that he might lose him. So he had hoped that maybe if he met with Paul enough times, Paul might bribe him with money. And look what he did. He even did meet with Paul. Look at that. Wherefore he sent for him the oftener, more often, if you will, and communed with him. So Felix even called for Paul to, hey, send him in again. Have him come one more time. I want to hear that one more time. Maybe this time it'll hit me just right. Maybe this time something will be said. Or maybe this time I'll have that tingle. I don't know what it was, but Felix kept calling for him to come, really hoping, right, that he would get money. Felix was playing, friend, a very dangerous game with God. Don't do this. Learn from Felix, friend. Do not play games. Do not suppose that next Sunday you'll do it. Because look what happens. After about 2 years, verse 27. After 2 years of this game going on between Felix and God, Felix hoping to pad his pockets, playing around with God's conviction in his life, look what happens. Porcius Festus came into Felix's room. What does that mean? Felix was reassigned, or maybe he was terminated from his position. But a new guy took over his place. Felix was no longer needed there for whatever reason. Porcius Festus comes in, and he's the new guy. As far as we know, Felix never heard the gospel again. My hope is that somewhere along the line, the guy got saved. But the Holy Spirit kind of makes us think here that he never heard it again. You don't know when you will be removed from a situation like Felix was, for any reason. Do not allow the conviction of God to go without you acknowledging it and obeying him, because we're not promised a better time or another time. This is a fact, a truth, a warning this morning to those who may be considering a relationship with Jesus and putting it off perpetually. Can I ask you this morning not to put it off again? Can I ask you this morning to just say, enough's enough? I'm not gonna bank on a next time. I'm gonna make it happen today. Would you trust Jesus today? The Holy Spirit and his conviction is not something to play games with. That goes for those who are not saved and for those who are saved. Brothers and sisters, we still have a Holy Spirit who will speak to our hearts and bring conviction to us from time to time. And you know when the right time to respond is? Right when he speaks. Humble ourselves. If he calls something to our attention that needs to be addressed, a sin or something that's distracting us, or a call that he has in our life, respond right there. It's the best time because it's the only time we're guaranteed. So what will it be today? What is he saying to you in this moment? How has he spoken to your heart? Do you need to ask Jesus to save you? Do it now. Christian, has he put a call on your life? Has he asked you to take a step or to reach out to someone? Would you respond to him today? If you'd stand with me, please, and our musicians, they would come. We would like to invite you to respond to the Lord right in this moment. Okay? You're not responding to me. You're not responding to anyone else. Not your neighbor, not me. You're responding to the Lord. So if you would just take this moment, I'm just going to ask everybody to bow their head and close their eyes so we can have a private moment with just you and the Lord. Would you do that? Just bow your head, close your eyes, and just you and the Lord right now. Okay, what is he saying to you right now? What did he say to you while we were looking at this account of Felix? as he spoke, what did he put his finger on in your life and say that right there? How are you going to respond to him? Are you going to obey? Please don't say maybe next time. Would you respond to him right now? What's he saying to you? Talk to him. If he's saying, be saved today, would you right there where you are begin this conversation with him and just reach out to him by faith and say, Lord Jesus, I realize I'm a sinner. I am unrighteous before you. You are holy. I am not. And I know, Jesus, that separates me from you and from the Father. And so, Lord Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins, that you would save my soul. Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross for my sins, and that you were buried, and that you rose from the dead. And I'm not trusting what I can do, but I'm trusting, Jesus, what you have done. Please save me. Would you reach out to him right now and just ask him to save your soul? Do it right now. Maybe you're here and you're saved. What has he said to you? Talk to him. He hears you. He knows you. And he loves you. Our folks are going to sing. And as they sing, right where you're at, or maybe you want to come forward and just pray. It's open. You can come forward if you'd like. But you talk to the Lord as they sing at this time. With every head bowed and every eye closed, nobody looking, please. I just want to ask this morning, if you're here and you'd say, for the first time today, I ask Jesus to save my soul, would you lift your hand so I can see it? I won't say your name. I won't embarrass you. I wouldn't embarrass you for the world. Maybe you would just lift your hand and say, today I ask Jesus to save my soul. Anybody like that at all? Just slip your hand up and right back down so I can see it. Brothers and sisters, how did God speak to you today? I'm not looking either. I want you in this moment, just as a testimony, that you would say, today God spoke to my heart about something, and I'm done putting it off. I'm done waiting. I'm going to respond to him now. Would you just lift your hand? Nobody's looking, not even me. You just lift your hand and say, today God has spoken to me, and as a testimony of that, I'm lifting my hand to say he's spoken, and I'm ready to make a decision. Just lift your hand. You can put those down whenever. Nobody's looking. We're so glad you came today. I want you to consider what the Lord has spoken in your heart today as you exit today. God bless you for coming. And here's what I'd like to ask you to do. If you are here for the first time, please meet me in the back corner here. I have a gift I'd love to give to you. If you did trust Christ today, please meet me back there. We're going to give you a New Testament from the church and congratulate you on the best decision you'll ever make, okay? So I'd love to meet you back there. Otherwise, tonight, 5 o'clock, we'll have our evening service, quarterly business meeting at the end of that, and I think that's it. We have ensemble at 4. Ensemble at 4, all right. That's all for announcements. We'll be dismissed in prayer. Brother Fred Holland, would you close us, please?